before we get to it, I was wondering if you had any opening remarks or kind of broad observations or opening statement you'd like to make.
Well, thank you. As well as being the president of the Community Broadcasting Association of Australia, I also run a community radio station, Hope Media Limited, here in Sydney. Hope 1032 is the station. The Community Broadcasting Association is the peak sector representative body for community broadcasting stations. Community broadcasting in Australia is acknowledged as the most successful media sector of its type in the world due to the support of successive governments since the early 1970s, the commitment of untold volunteers over more than 40 years, and the millions of listeners each week who value the independence and diversity of the community broadcasting sector. The committee's inquiry into the future of public interest journalism has been prompted in part by changing technology and new and emerging delivery platforms that are forcing significant change onto traditional media operators who are being forced to develop new business models to survive. These same factors are impacting community media, although our business model, based as it is in serving our communities, seems to be more resilient. That, however, may not always be the case, and we appreciate the opportunity to appraise the committee today of the role community broadcasting plays in public interest journalism and in an open society, a strong democracy, and a vibrant culture. And I'd love to hand over to the CEO of the CPLA, Mr. John Bissett, for some further comments.
Thanks. I'll just give a little bit of a background on community radio that's a little bit extended from what's in the submission. So our recent list of figures are 5.3 million Australians listening to community radio each week, so a sizable number of listeners.
5.3 million.
And this is
a huge figure.
With about 800,000 listening exclusively to community radio, so there's significant figures. There's 450 stations around the country that are faith-based or Indigenous, ethnic, print handicapped, youth seniors, it's educational stations, and of course it's general stations, which is sort of including specialist music stations as well. And our business is growing. I think we've shown growth over the last 10 years in listener numbers, but also in other figures. At the moment, the stations in the sector turn over in excess of $103 million per year, with 75%, so three quarters of that coming from community sourced income, being either membership or subscriber fees or donations. So over $75 million coming from the community to our stations. The sector is also growing in membership numbers. We're up 93% in the last 4 years. We've got now 210,000 members per year subscribing to community radio stations. So or members of community radio stations, so sizable numbers. There's 26,000 volunteers, again that's up, and over 1,000 paid staff in the sector, so quite sizable. In all of the research that we do, the number one reason people listen to community radio is for local information and news. And I particularly like to make a few comments about Indigenous community media and then just give you a couple of examples around the sort of news and information that stations are giving you. So Indigenous media is providing a sort of a first level of service for Indigenous communities across the country. It also is a cultural bridge between Indigenous and non-Indigenous communities. And I think what's really important is that audiences are unanimously praising Indigenous radio as an alternative source of news and information that rejects the stereotyping of Indigenous issues by the mainstream media. It's a really important and critical part of our sector. In other parts of the sector, I thought I'd just give you a few examples of some of the news and information being delivered. For example, Griffith Community Radio Station is broadcasting local council meetings so that the locals can hear what's happening in their local government. Hot FM in Mildura has partnered with local newspapers to provide local news. And I think what we're hearing more and more is stations are becoming much more localised. For example, in Glen Innes, they're broadcasting 12 to 15 hours a day of live or locally produced content compared to other sectors that are broadcasting about 3 hours a day, with the rest being networked in talkback or other services from Sydney. So community radio's producing more local content. We play more Australian music and support a greater diversity of Australian cultures than many of the other broadcasters. I think, you know, importantly to us, the likely reduction in the number of media owners suggests that services offered by community broadcasting are probably only going to get more and more important as time goes on. And we really hope that the government and the crossbenchers and Nick, you've been, Xenophon, you've been extremely supportive of community radio, continues to support us, and we'd love to take any questions.
Okay. Really excited by those figures. Those figures are kind of surprising about how large that is. And
he wants his own show now.
Dasher and Zeno are the getting it all working. And we do well.
Yeah.
That's right. No, we have fun.
I don't think you should quit our day job, so I might have to.
too soon. But look, I'm a little bit fascinated by, I'm seeing from a Sydney perspective. How much, when you talk about the faith-based radio and the kind of multicultural, kind of ethnic-based radio, how big are those sectors? Like, I've appeared on a couple of kind of ethnic radio shows in Sydney. I don't know if anyone listens to them. Some I'm sure do.
I'll start with the ethnic sector.
Yeah.
The ethnic sector is, and it depends on how you talk about size. I think with ethnic stations, what they particularly do is... I would say 2000 FM in Sydney, which is the ethnic station here, will broadcast, I don't know their numbers exactly, but it'll be 50 or 60 different languages across the week. So each language community will
have... It's a couple of hours.
Yeah.
And that's one out of UTS, is that one?
No, they're out of Burwood, so they've got their own facility in Burwood.
Well,
they've
got a show on them.
Yeah. And I think you spoke at the ethnic broadcasting conference last year.
Yes.
I might ask Philip... seeing he's the CEO of a faith-based station, to actually answer the question, the faith-based question.
There are two distinct faith-based sectors, I suppose. Yep. In Sydney, there is a Muslim community radio station, and the only one in Australia. And then the Christian faith-based sector. There are some 35 stations around Australia that are licensed to serve the Christian community of interest.
Wow. What do you mean by licensed to serve the Christian community? I mean, there's not a specific license you get for Christian radio. I mean, you just a licensed radio station that does Christian costs.
Yeah, so ACMA awards or grants licenses, and each license has a designated community of interest.
Ah.
So that community of interest will either be to the Christian community, it might be to the ethnic community, it might be to a youth community.
But you tend to be broader than that.
Yeah, and you...
Yes.
Yeah.
Or you can try to. Okay, so you've got 35 Christian...
So there are 35 stations that are licensed specifically to serve the Christian community of interest, and then many of the other community stations around the country may carry some amount of Christian content, just the same as many generalist stations carry ethnic content and content from other faiths.
Yes, of course.
So it's a fairly significant, the faith-based stations are a fairly significant part of the community.
Okay, there's something that we had in the hearing yesterday, and we had, and this is a bit that kind of interested me, we had yesterday the Rural and Regional Papers came and kind of spoke to us. And they said the single biggest problem they've got, or sorry, single biggest way that we could help what they do. I see what you do at a community journalist level in the same way as a lot of what they do, in that you tell, you know, I mean, they use this term, they love thing of record, paper of record, but you're the community voice, you're where community voices can talk to each other. It's fantastic that I can get a podcast right now and listen to Meet the Press in the US when I go for a run. That's not going to tell me about what's happening in my
runs, do you?
Well, I used to. Except before we snack grass. This is just descending. but if I was... their suggestion was this. Is the idea that they had, which I was quite excited about, was when we look at government advertising and government advertising campaigns, they were saying, why isn't a part of that kept aside for regional... papers, and I thought beyond that, why wouldn't we signify a component of that to community radio if we want to support these industries? I mean, that fact that still blew me away from yesterday's Xenophon was that the awareness campaign for the marine park in South Australia around
changes to marine park legislation, it was no advertising on in the local media much, wouldn't cost much. Then Kangaroo Island.
And they're buying ads in the advertising. Like that kind of, is there a way? I don't know.
There's a number of challenges, and we have written to the government and the prior Labor government about this exact issue. And we had some, we commissioned some research into this because we believe there's to a degree, a bias against community radio because we are, for a start, we aren't part of the commercial radio's ratings.
Yeah.
So what actually happens is government is giving their media spend to media buying agencies. Those media buying agencies are typing into the computers.
Yeah. I know, exactly.
Data, and we're not in this.
It certainly happens with, you know, ethnic press and that. Yeah, there is a stipulated amount. Yeah. So, let's hypothetically, a big player, I'm going to use Ogilvy as an example, and you know, they're a big, and they're great at what they do. They win this big contract. Let's say they win the no jab, no pay contract, right?
Yeah.
Let's say, and I don't know the figures, let's say that's 50 million. Again, could be 10, could be 50, I don't know. Let's say it's 50 million. Then they go and do their advertising. Yeah, they buy six, seven places. It's a lot easier. Buying community radio, let's face it, is logistically more difficult.
And Sandra, I think that's one of the challenges when you're looking at buying a fairly diverse sector, like the community broadcasting sector. It's not as easy as plugging some numbers into a computer and it tells you where to buy. The reality is with 5.3 million listeners a week, 800,000 of which are only listening to community radio, there's a fairly large portion of the Australian community that's being missed out when advertising dollars are only spent on commercial media. So we would be fully supportive of the government looking to ensure that it reaches all of the people it needs to with its campaigns by purchasing community radio. And there are agencies who handle the community sector. It's not that the government has to deal with individual stations. They can go to agencies.
As far as you are aware, does any data exist on how much government expenditure is spent on community radio advertising?
Not that we're aware of. We have actually asked for that data. One of our recommendations. We're not aware that that can be produced and has never been produced as far as we're aware. We'd be very interested. I mean, we anecdotally know that the spend is down, but it's very hard to get those exact figures.
Mm. Okay, so if that's the part, I mean, I'm just thinking of practical ways that we can assist. I mean, obviously that's a practical kind of recommendation. Mm. So what we would be, again, it's a matter for the committee to deliberate on, but what we could recommend is that a proportion, that a designated proportion of government advertising be directed, or the radio advertising, if you're doing radio ad campaigns, unless you can, unless there's a reason why not.
What are the rules with community radio? You're not an you're not a commercial broadcaster, but
we are allowed to effectively take a Coca-Cola advertisement, and we can't play that unless we tag it with station sponsor, and by law it moves from being an advertisement, which we're not allowed to play, a sponsorship which we are allowed to play simply by adding the words station sponsor. So we can take government advertising and simply tag it with station sponsor.
I think we do take a lot of community kind of local advertising.
We do, and just to add, we're also limited to 5 minutes per hour.
Right. So that's a good problem to have for
your
stations, right?
Yes and no.
what's the average? I mean, generally, 5 minutes per hour, can you put in more than 5 minutes? Is that 5 minutes for any 1 hour, or is it 24 times five?
No, it's 5 minutes per hour. That is a challenge for us, and there's a lot of regulation around what we can and can't do, and I suppose our thinking for the future is that is possibly one area that needs some looking into to give us more flexibility to be more entrepreneurial in the future. So I think there are some challenges around, you know, it's like the legislation was written in
1992, the current version.
Yeah, so it hasn't really changed.
Out more of it than the internet by then, or not?
Just.
Google's next door, mate.
So things have changed. But there is certainly some opportunities.
So if we, I mean, there's two parts to that. One part is just making sure we have data, which you're saying that you're not aware of being kept.
No, we're not aware of being kept.
But I can't, I mean, I don't want to look into this, but I couldn't see why you couldn't say that if part of your advertising campaign is going to be X and there's a radio component, that a portion of a radio component should be community radio. unless there's a reason not to. I mean, same as we do with ethnic press stipulation. I mean, again, there may be a reason why a campaign's just being run in one city for whatever purpose, that's understandable, but I can't see why you couldn't stipulate that, especially like the broader campaign. Give you an example, right? The No Jab, No Pay is probably a good one, right? That'll be a huge campaign, as have been the big AIDS campaigns in the past, and the big public awareness health campaigns run at a federal level. Do you get a stake, do you get a cut of that?
We don't, if it's going through a media buying agency, very rarely. However, we are, our Minister Hunt has recently launched for us our suicide prevention program, where the Department of Health is paying us approximately $1 million over 3 years to run suicide prevention messages. Now, that's being funded out of the department, not through a media buying agency.
Yeah.
So we have much more success with those sorts of things.
Is there $1 million over the whole network of community radio?
So it's essentially being used, so it's across 3 years, so it's, that's being used to produce monthly bulletins, and that money essentially goes into the production of the content, and a small amount for distribution across the network, and then stations decide what to play and how to play.
Given how many stations and given all the costs, right, that seems like a pretty good
and the stations, the individual stations are not getting any funding for that. They're essentially playing those as community service announcements, or they're normally interviews with the minister or with the chair of Beyond Blue, or with...
You have to pay $1 million to put the minister on.
Well,
I'm joking. I think that's something I'll leave my question in doubt. That's something I want to practically go away and look at, but that could be something. I mean, you're not going to argue against it.
No, we've done some work on that, so we could make a follow-up submission with some of that.
If you could have a look at what would be a practical way that if we decided that we wanted to give support for community radio, what's a practical recommendation that would have, beyond the we all want to protect journalism and stuff, which is all great, but we kind of want to have things at the end of this that we can point to and say, right, we'll do this with your advertising spend. That'll have a real impact because that will ensure these stations will... And not only does it reach a whole bunch of people you can reach otherwise, but it also, it can do more than one good thing.
I should disclose that I started my foray into media community radio doing the Nick X film reviews for 5UV.
Really?
Well done.
The Nick X film reviews?
Yeah, about 35 years ago or longer. 40 years.
Were they X-rated?
Or only when I swore once, which I got in trouble for.
We have been trying to find copies.
I don't think there's any copies. Okay. So, can you say something about community radio? Because at 5UV, and it's had its own issues with the University of Adelaide, and it's now was Radio Adelaide, and it lost it to called something else now because ABC took over that, Radio Melbourne, Radio Adelaide, Radio Sydney tagging. What I noticed in my time there is that you trained a lot of people in radio production and journalism skills, and chasing stories. And how many people do you try? It seemed like an incredibly good and incredibly cost-effective way of training people. Do you get any funding for, in terms of training programs? Because if you want to learn the skills of being involved in radio production, editing, things that you can always leapfrog across into video and film, what programs are there for community radio on that?
I'll let John handle the funding side at the moment.
It's important in the context of diversity.
I suppose the comment I'd make initially is that certainly the community sector over the last 10 of media people in Australia, the number of people who've gone through community radio and community television and have ended up in the commercial world is very significant.
So do you get any assistance from that, from education training programs?
We certainly get some government funding towards training, and John can cover that in a moment. But certainly our sector has taken the role of training, whereas in the past it was always done in regional commercial radio, and that's simply not happening as much now as it was in the past.
The government provides it's approximately $800,000 per year for community radio training. And that is used primarily to deliver vocational training in media.
So how much is that?
About 800,000.
Is that state or federal?
That is federal. There is, from time to time, stations or the community media training organisation, which is a partnership of the sector really to deliver vocational and RTO to deliver vocational training and get the most of that 800,000. They are delivering training through stations and directly on a day-to-day basis. But there's also many other things happening. So Radio Adelaide, up until recently, was an RTO themselves. 4AAA in Brisbane, they're an Indigenous station, is also an RTO and delivering training direct to Indigenous media people there. But then there's also, for example, Charlestown University, through their partnership with the CBAA, my organisation, to deliver national radio news, where they're using journalism students in the School of Journalism at Charlestown University to basically do news. And that's also happening at Curtin University.
And it's a very valuable training ground there.
And many other university sort of stations. So there's a lot of training happening, and most stations also deliver training to their own volunteers and staff as well.
Thank you. So really, you rely on the issue that Senator Destiari raised, the chair raised, is quite important about getting a fair share of ad revenue, but it's also this direct grants from government to help make it happen.
Yeah, exactly. And I think importantly though, the sector is, the government funding is extremely important, and it provides really important services that enable it, like training, like digital radio infrastructure, those sorts of things that are much more difficult to find commercial models to actually do, whereas stations are primarily operating on, the average station has 10%, for example, of federal government funding as their revenue. So most of the money is coming from their own operations, which I think is really important to note too.
That's fine. And the recent announcements that One Nation made in the context of community radio, were you aware of those announcements before they were made? Or conditional?
Yeah, we've been having discussions with all of the crossbench. We were certainly aware that I think all the crossbench were pretty much supportive of the digital radio funding, because that came up in the motion in Parliament and Senate, in May, June, whenever that was. We were surprised with some of the other announcements. We're certainly not disappointed, but we were surprised that they came up. But we also think they are extremely valuable. One of those was to boost national radio news services. So at the moment, for example, national radio news is a national service, which will enable us to make it more localised, for example, if that money did come through.
So how much is that involved? Was it clear to me how that package would be split?
I probably have as much knowledge as what was in the Minister's press release, which was, I think, $800,000 for national radio news.
Over what period?
Per year for 4 years.
So that would make a difference in terms of the number of journalists being employed.
Yeah,
would that be local? How would that be local?
Look, to be honest, we have not done a lot of planning around that. We were surprised that that actually came up. We've been doing some work around enhancing our news service in two ways, really. One, developing a hub, which is a piece of technology, a piece of software, that will enable the sector to more collaboratively share news content, but also to grow our news services so that there are more journalists across the country. But the detail of how we will do that, particularly if this money comes through, there's still a lot of work to be done. But we would probably see doing it in partnership with possibly Charlestown University or other universities, so we can continue to draw on that training support and make the most out of that money.
Legislation isn't through yet, there's still a lot more under the bridge, so wait and see. But thank you very much. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you. Just take me through the licensing step. I was just doing a little bit of research, and again, I'm new to that structure. So how does does someone create a community radio station? How does the... I'm not a bachelor, it's okay.
Well, the process is that, generally speaking, in a community, a group would come together with a desire to put to air a community radio station. They would form a company limited by guarantee or an incorporated association or even a cooperative. They would then go to the ACMA as the regulator to identify potential spare frequencies in their area, and then a process of establishing bona fides, ensuring that they had correct constitution and governance structures in place would be undertaken, and would be likely after a number of months that they would be able to get a temporary broadcasting license from the ACMA, which would allow them to effectively do test broadcasts to prove both their capacity to deliver the license, but also the desire of the community to have a license. Pretty much right around Australia at the moment, there are, in every state, there are groups currently going through this temporary broadcasting license scenario, and the aim eventually is that they would move from a temporary license to a full community.
Is there a lot of churn? License.
Not a lot of churn.
I'm just trying to think, the last, you might lose, there's currently 60 temporary licences
in Australia,
the rest up to 450, so what's 390 are permanent licensees. I've been in the role of 4.5 years, I think one or two might have ceased broadcasting.
How many licences would there be, say, I don't know if you break it down by state, just...
In terms of...
Anecdotally, like, you don't have to mean exactly.
And what's the phone number of all the
In Sydney, there are not, to my knowledge, any aspirant broadcasters on temporary licences.
Yeah.
But there are 8 full-power metropolitan-wide services,
yep.
And then something in the order of maybe another 15 suburban licences,
yep.
Sub-metro suburban licences.
Yeah, I know some of them, yeah. And do a lot of them then you go to one of the... someone who already has the equipment, this is why UTS and Build and then Centre, they kind of provide that service, is that how it works?
The ethnic stations are probably a little bit different to a lot of the other stations. So the ethnic stations tend to be groups of, like a multicultural organisation,
yeah.
Like a Greek organisation or an Iranian or a
yeah.
something organisation that...
You just put Greek and Iranian out of just...
Actually, I didn't think about it.
Yeah,
just
yeah, yeah.
It.
Best of friends. Because what amazes me, this is the bit that surprised me, and this is not a matter for you per se, I mean, it affects your members, but you take the ethnic broadcasting in Sydney and the community broadcast. SBS is even another good example of this, because SBS radio doesn't have any code. And you look at the amount we spend on de-radicalisation, terrorism awareness programs, and then you wonder why isn't it being... We have this problem that SBS doesn't get it. Right? We started arranging meetings between SBS and the Attorney General's Department because of this, but not just them, take it to the community level, right? Where it just strikes me as odd, we're better to be spending your de-radicalisation anti-terrorism money, which is one of the few places in a very, very tight budget where there is money, right? And so there should be, right? But this is where there's money, right? Where better would you think to be spending it than in these community radio stations that, you know, are speaking the language to these communities at that very, very grassroots level? And the money goes to big agencies that spend it in full page ads, in metro papers and TV. You know what I mean? Like, it always struck me as a bit odd how we don't target some of these.
Like the people smuggler ads
yeah.
In doing radio. They were doing radio ads here when they should have been doing them in Indonesia and Malaysia.
No comment.
I suppose it was your government.
It was our government, it was Australian government. But I'm saying these are the kind of... What I'm really fascinated in is these opportunities that, again, strike me as the way in which things get done by government. I'm not malicious. I just think when it comes to advertising and spending, we're just not, you know, nimble. Sarandu, you made an observation earlier that kind of stuck with you. You said in part because... it's easier for the agencies not to, right? It's easier to buy 4 places at once, right? It's easier to plug in or stereo, but they should be advertising that as well. That's part of it is difficult. You made other point to it, it's because the data isn't there or something about you can't monitor the...
Yes, it's one of the challenges. So the commercial radio sector, along with the public broadcasters, the ABC and SBS, commissioned audience research in
yeah,
the major markets. and that audience research is not available to the community sector.
No,
so we commission our own research, but it's a very different type of research. The commercial radio stations are doing diary systems and basically getting quarter hour listening statistics, which allows them to do reach and frequency numbers. Agencies understand that language. In the community sector, because we simply don't have the pockets that are deep enough to afford that type of survey, our data is much more top level. So it's about listening to particular times of the day, particular days of the week, particular stations. And that data doesn't easily translate to reach and frequency, which is the language that the agencies understand.
And also when they're dealing with clients, they're trying to get
back. And the cost per market to do...
But I mean, the difference is we're talking about a very different client here. We're talking about government who can have... You know, I can understand why if you're Coca-Cola and you're a Coca-Cola executive, that data, you need an advertiser who want to provide them with that data. But I just think there's an opportunity in more than one good. But look, I think we're going around in circles.
You would never do that. It's actually very useful, and I think...
Yeah, that was really fascinating. Thank you. I think that's some quite good recommendation to get out of that. Mr. Bissett, Mr. Randall, thank you so much for being here with us today. And I believe you're taking on notice, perhaps providing a letter